What's going on, everybody? I'm back with another unboxing. This time around, it's a special one. This is Arturo Fuentes Cigar Factory Tour. So I was very fortunate enough that everything aligned up correctly, and I was able to go on not only the Chateau de la Fuente tour, but also the Cigar Factory tour. This is a really long one. It's over an hour long, but they were kind and generous enough to open their doors to the Pro Cigar guests, and we got to see just about everything. It was really incredible. We got to see the factory where they actually make all the cigar boxes in house. We saw the rolling. We saw the aging room. We saw that Carlito really likes to document everything that they do, so they hold on to basically everything. So that's why, as you watch the video, you'll see that there's just pieces of history of this company scattered throughout the factory floor. And I was unaware that the factory just recently went through some renovation and changes, so we were really fortunate enough to see just how impressive and what a beautiful operation that Carlito and the Fuente family are running. So it was a treat. It was a once in a lifetime opportunity, and it was just a great experience, and I'm really really fortunate that I can share that with you guys. So like I said, it's an hour long. Carlito was on the tour with us. He gave us just bits and pieces of the history of his family, along with some of the struggles and some of the failures that happened in their 100 plus year history. So this is a special one, guys. I hope you guys enjoy. Questions, comments, leave them below. Cigar Unboxing on Instagram. Stay well, be well, smoke well, and I'll catch you on the next one. Thanks, guys.
So plywood, we make a nice box. Here's what we make, all the boxes, where we put our cigars in. First floor, cutting, assembling. Second floor, finishing.
This is a 3D printer.
No, it was
It's not a 3D printer?
No, I just asked you.
No.
CNC.
Thank you.
Muchas gracias. Thank you. Coffee. He's asking what you want.
¡Gracias! Please,
it would be a shame for you to come here. I don't know how many times you come. Hopefully you come a lot so I can explain some of the things, but it's so heavy. Let me, I don't know what's going to here. There are so many things. Remember I spoke about anyway, remember, I spoke to you about every single thing, the details and everything. This was inspired by, if you look, that last mural, the center, that is the Columbia restaurant where I used to go with my grandfather. That has, I forgot about, 15 different rooms, the ballrooms. It's huge. It's two square blocks and two floors. And that's the bathroom room. And I was always impressed with that, with the sunlight coming in and so forth. But every single way here, I just want to go over here the mural so you understand or see what I wanted to accomplish. I'm gonna just walk over here and just show you. A lot of people think when they see the images and you see them walk. You probably think, well, that's Havana, that's Cuba, goes to the middle. That's probably, that's my hometown. That's where I was born. That's E4 City. That's where my father was born. Mother was born. And my grandfather had the factory that's in the world. And if you look at this image, my grandfather's factory, which is the one right over here, you see A20 for Tampa Sweethearts, that was his factory in 1912. In 1924, that factory burned down to the ground while my grandfather was in Cuba. There was a fire and that building was made out of wood. It burned to the ground and not there. My grandfather literally refused to get to the bathroom. And he worked for years for other factories. The general manager there burned down to the ground. And so he was able to start his factory again. So he started in the back of his house. The front of his house where my grandparents lived, got back, they added to it. Again, wood. Remember what it comes with? Tin roof, where my father was born and where I was born. He added to the back. Now the back of the house, this is my grandfather's who was born here. That's the house where I lived until I was about 4 years old before my father was here for the same. My parents were 18 years old when they left. I was born 9 months ago. They made it out of high school, they were married on June 14th. Next week they got married. I guess the next night, I was married. I was creative. I went to the Lord's place. To me, this is just crazy. It's pretty much a whole. That's my grandfather, Bill Clinton. This man here, the age of 17, my grandmother, Christina Reeder, who is Christina Pointer, who is my father's mother.
Thank you.
To put the cigars here for a period of time, so all the components, because the wrapper, when you put it in a cigar, is 24% of humidity, the binder is 18% of humidity, and the filler should be 16, and when you have to smoke it, the proper humidity level is 13, so everything has to go slow to 13, and all the components get together to make that nice taste. Our cigars are already, you can go around and get to all the aisles, don't worry.
Jose, when you put these in the car just to rest, do you rotate them or just leave them as is?
We don't touch them anymore. And the components are already 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 years aged. So the cigar just made is already an aged cigar, but you need to all the components to get together, you know? That's why we put them here. Keep coming in.
Oh, pardon me. Mm-hmm.
You are a normal guy.
That's the question I get.
Right.
Come on, guys. It's right here.
Well, this is one of 18, man. Look at all that. Look at everyone. The police see
it. I'm keying you.
Come on. Everybody wants to sleep here.
What do you say?
Vamos, Jordi.
Come on. Right here, please.
We come in, we come in, we check.
He comes with you, he's batting the hand.
Yeah. No, we come and check and everything. Not all the time.
By the chemicals. The huevo, what's inside, gets blown because of the low temperature, minus 30 degrees Celsius.
For how long?
So when you take the cigar, 1 week. 1 week because the freezer is off. People with normal clothes, they get in, put the cigars, they get out, and they turn on. They don't go like that. It will explode also. So this is our new aging room. Maybe next time you will see it full of cigars.
And this is for how long? This, it depends on how long you want to age it for.
Yeah, that's right. This has the devices of a cooling system also. Did you say this is the oldest aging room? Opus, this? No. Opus is only number one. This is number 17. Oh, yeah. A little elevator, but not for this moment. Okay, let's wait for some of our friends to come this way. Now we are going to move to another area. Where we were a few minutes ago, so we make a up and down. That should be the place. Follow me. Some of the old front page of Cigar Aficionado.
We noticed that.
That's the only one I noticed. So I said, now you're happy days. Now we go this way. He doesn't know where he's going, but he's going the right way. Here we are preparing the blend for the Opus X. We prepare all plants in other buildings, but this one we prepared here.
Okay.
Enjoy that. This is a... All these bales, we don't have it here. That goes into the other building where we separate the leaves and make the pesada. This is one pesada. You're coming. That is real tobacco from our farm. Maybe it's a little bit dry because this is not a proper place to have. Yeah. That's the way it hangs. Since maybe we didn't have the chance to move to the farm or maybe square, whatever. This is a little space we took to show you the thing about tobacco. Bales, tobacco hanging in your tobacco box. And some of the filler that is the head of these. So what is it with this? This.
Caballero, echen un paso para atrás. Porque no me asisto a la chica embarazada.
Seen that done here, but they wanted to give an illustration because we are so spread out. Villa Gonzalez has 40,000 bales of aged tobacco. It goes with 14 warehouses. We have so many things we can't show it off. We're in the process of building a theater here now. So when you walk in a big theater, you can see everything from the farm, the growing, things that you're not allowed to see when you come as a visitor. But I congratulate you, whoever had that idea and everything. But that tobacco, that's unique. I can see it's still green, it's been processed. Man, okay, count the leaves, multiply it by two. That's how many less ovaries you're gonna have. But that tobacco, what's that I wanna say? Because that tobacco, we're gonna come out with a $200 cigar, okay? Okay, talking about, I remember Hurricane Irene. I live up in the hill. You know, some of your Gran Mirante go from the top and see the hills across the street where some homes. That's where my home is at. And I remember I got a call at 5:30 in the morning, and the sun was just starting to come up. I got a call. There was a fire in the Gonzales, and we have a warehouse. And I, oh my God, you know, what could you think? I was preparing, had all these tobacco for 100th anniversary. This is a big thing. I never thought, really, you know, when we hit 90 years old or 88 years old, that I was gonna ever see them. Now, that seems like something that's a milestone of achievement that you don't live 100 years. And I started saving, you know, certain tobaccos, different blends and things like that. The year before, or a year and a half before that we were gonna introduce them, it would have been introduced at the RTDA back then, had this big fire. It was a hurricane. When there's a hurricane coming to the Caribbean, there was only one flight in and out of Miami, or two flights. There was only American Airlines. And they take all the aircrafts out of here. They don't take it to Miami because they know that from here it goes to Miami. My father was in Tampa. He couldn't get out. He couldn't get to Miami, he couldn't get here. And it was eventually, 3 days later, was Lucido was able to get a private plane to fly. They had to fly all around the bottom side of Cuba and everything to come back up to the north, but they couldn't, there was no flights. And I said, man, oof. I remember Wally Beagle, Rich Dolak, Zero. I was there the third day. There's still tobacco, I don't know if it was motoring or something, there was still smoke coming out of some of the bales for 3 days. We had to knock with bulldozers the walls down. Firemen couldn't get in. Very primitive, the fire department, things like that. And the fire was out, but it was still some smoke. And I remember when I saw my father, you can imagine. I said I didn't want to remember, but I saw him getting out of the car and he said, composure, composure, you gotta be strong, composure. The father said, Alito, I can't imagine. Because he saw which warehouses were. They were the most secure warehouses that we had, all the supplies in the back. And, he said, Alito, it's okay, son, you okay? I'm sorry, I couldn't be here. I want to be with you. I remember that morning, looking out. I could see the final speaker, Diego Delgado, I could see everything, and I saw smoke going up the air. And I hate to use this word because the relativity or the comparison is not good. It was a mushroom. It reminded me of all those I've seen. I just saw smoke going straight up. And I told my father, I said, Dad, I feel good, Dad. I'm good with this. Don't worry. Together, we'll make it better. I said, I'm happy because the smell that I smelled here and everything. Remember, there was no electricity in the building. There was no, everything was wood and burlap bales and racks, metal racks where they were stacked and pallets out of wood. So everything that was burning was tobacco. And I said, Dad, the aroma was just delicious. I feel good because the smoke went up to the heavens. And my grandfather, my uncles, my aunts, everybody who's passed before me are enjoying the best tobacco in the world. And that's when I had to think really quick and come up with an anniversary cigar. That's how Angel Share came about. I had to re-blend, and that's when I came up with the Steven Seagal. So sometimes when you look at things like this, you have a tragedy, you look at it as an opportunity and find out God speaks to you in many different ways just to learn how to listen. Okay, thank you. We'll say back to you.
Thank you. Here, 1980, first started here after Nicaragua. There's a door behind us, one door that goes from the offices. That's the way you enter the factory, those two double doors to my right, to your back. And that was the main rolling room. And that's where the cigar tables, that's where my father started with seven people. And actually, first cigars were made in September 1980. Well, my father started here in January 1980, and I moved a couple of weeks after to the Dominican Republic. Now, you have to build tables, you have to put lights, you have to start from scratch. There was nothing here, it was an empty building where they manufactured clothing, but they were leaving, and this was the only building that was going to become available. It was only 12,000 square feet. I have no effing idea how many square feet between all the floors are. But he went through a friend of his who we used to buy tobacco from, one of our suppliers here in Dominican Republic. Recommended two people who was very close to him. One was an electrician, one was a carpenter. That's how my father started. Because he needed someone to put up the lights, wire, and he needed somebody to help him build the tables. The first car my father bought when he came here was this 1979 Datsun 120Y. And he paid $4,700. He used to go to the hardware store and bring lumber. Here, build the tables. And then he used to go to the tobacco warehouse and bring in one bale at a time. We have a bale, a symbolic bale, a bale in the back of the truck. That's how I used to bring it in. This was the ramp. This was the only way in and out of the cigar factory back then. No longer ramp. And We had everything eventually right here and right next door with the packing. Everything was in this little area. So my father used to bring a bale at a time. And the barn, the free zone was a lot different. There was no security. It was just like a barbed wire chain link fence. And there were all these vendors and the selling food and people. It was all full of semi trucks outside, and people would sit under the semi trucks to have lunch and everything. It was very difficult. Now it's not that way, thank God. It's really nice. This is really good. It's not what it was in 1980. So my father, this new car, would park it outside. Everybody was sitting on it, looking at it. They didn't see cars. And my father said, they're gonna ruin the car, this and that. So he used to bring in two planks and drive the car in here. This car was completely, after a while, he got another car, but this car was used to run errands with a chauffeur and everything for many, many, many years. But the car eventually, if you look behind you, that was in a warehouse. You can see it on blocks, this, that, you see lights are missing or whatever. Eventually that car was stripped from just employees, curious people, this, that. There was nothing, it was all rusted and so forth. And it was in our warehouse. And a lot of people used to come here in the press, and my father tell the story of how he started. He said, where's the car? And they went to our Villa Gonzalez, all the tobacco, to see the car, and said, what are you gonna do with it? He says, no, one day, I'm gonna put it up in the building. I'm gonna, without a motor or whatever, not heavy, just the body, and have it there, and put it like a trophy, so that I never forget how I started. My father, that was his dream. He never saw his dream. When my father became ill, that we knew he had his time counted, I spoke to Cyril. I said, Cyril, get the car. I want to see. Let's put it up in the building so my father can see it. But we didn't want that. He spoke to Santo Domingo Motors, who was the importer of this car back then in Santo Domingo. Very close friends, extension of his family. Very, very successful, big company. Imported all their GMs and a lot of different cars here. And he says, Carlito wants to restore the car to its original state. It took about, my father never saw it. It took about a year and a half to 2 years. It's a long story. This car was driven from Santo Domingo here. It's completely restored inside and out. Seats, everything to its original. Believe me, they had no seats, they had nothing. There was a hole in the roof from riding, where it rained inside. You can imagine, moldy, completely restored. Drove it in here, put the bale of tobacco. And this, not only a story, that's a true story. This is here for my children, and someday, grandchildren, to remember how we started here. So that's the story behind the culture. And that's my father back there with the car many years ago.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.